I'm Blake McCulley from Cross-Eyed Airbrushing in Calgary, Canada, and today we're going to do Ass Kicking Airbrush Advice. We're going to address some big issues today on this video. We have some tips that we're going to put together to make you a better, more successful artist. Now, this isn't going to be particularly easy. I'm going to try to demonstrate this through a demo panel. I'm going to create a demo panel, and I'm going to recreate a lot of mistakes in there that a lot of artists make. I'm going to try to fix them, and I'm going to address most of the questions that I get from the Airbrush Getaways. The Getaways are a workshop that a lot of students come to. We have top professional artists in the industry teaching you the best knowledge that they know possible. And we get a ton of questions that don't necessarily relate just to the artwork. So I'm going to try to address markets with you, clients, how to quote, how to deal with these things as I work through a project. And then I'm going to demonstrate a lot of the problems throughout the panel. Now, this panel is recreated from a back fender of a chopper that I created. It's going to go into some print ads, probably in t-shirts as well. We're going to create the better part of this. We're going to create the inside face. And within that face, I can probably recreate a lot of the mistakes that artists make. Now, I have a client on this project. This client already exists. I've already worked with this client, and we finished the project. But I'm going to walk you through how I dealt with this client and how we achieved this image, how we came up with this image. Now, my client approached me, and he came up with a lot of words that he wanted. And some of these words were just like fire and evil and nasty. So I had about 6 words to work from. Now, we went through our portfolio. Now, this is just my travel portfolio. And in this travel portfolio, there's a lot of information. I have a lot of sections of projects in here. And in these projects, he started pointing out the ones that he liked. Now, this gets you into your headspace, your client. He might get excited about this particular image or the background on another project. And you really got to pay attention when you're talking with your client as to which one he really, really likes. Also, make a real good note of what he doesn't like. If he mentions he doesn't like green, then you got to make sure you stay away from green. With this project right here, my client gave me about 6 or 7 words as well, pointed out 5 or 6 projects that he liked, and gave me tons of freedom. Whereas this project here, I wasn't allowed to do a lot of things. We couldn't take away from the bike too much, so we had to do a graphic that was very subtle yet had sharp impact, but didn't take away from the bike too much. You have to really understand your client. And when you're dealing with a client, really push them a lot and sell them and pitch them some cool ideas. He can be really proud of the project afterwards, and you've created something new. It gets a little boring painting the same eagle head over and over again. By pushing the client and really listening to him, you're going to succeed well. My client's 3 favorite projects were this project right here. He loved the nightmare attack of this. It looked like a bad dream. He loved the craziness of this project, like just the insanity of it. And he also liked the flow of this project here. So if I give him something that resembles these 3 projects, I know that he's going to be happy. After I took all this information, I had a jigsaw puzzle of 6 words that I had to put together. In doing so, I came up with a storyline and I pitched the storyline to him. I spent the better part of 2 nights on the sofa at night drawing out these ideas and tied a storyline. The storyline in this project was a character who started off on the front fender and he was introducing you and pulling you into the project to see his dream. On the top of the tank, he was showing you his dream. He was a Medusa head that came off with a bunch of dragon heads. And I just created this creepy character that was showing you his nasty dream. As you rolled around, the dragons flew down the oil bucket onto the back fender and he was just saying, okay, now you've seen my dream, now shut up and don't talk about it. It was a little storyline that tied throughout the whole bike, and he really dug this idea. Now, we've got a client here, and you want to really make this guy happy. It's his ass on the bike, not yours. He's going to see it every day that he rides this bike, so let's make him happy. You can't start a project till you're comfortable doing the work. I have to be comfortable before I start. He has to be comfortable with me doing his work. So make sure you have a great comfort zone. So now let's get to the drawing here. I've started working out some thumbnails. You start small, don't waste any time. Get your idea down really quick. Pick your light source. And you know, if there's a secondary light source, I pick them with little arrows. I don't want to waste a lot of time in this process. I just do little thumbnails until I start working it out. You know, I want it soft on this side. There's a dark shadow on this side. So I'll start drawing it all dark like this. There's no sense wasting a lot of time until I've figured out how my lighting is going to work. And then I can work on my image a little bit. If I'm starting to like this little thumbnail, I might do 3 or 4 of these. Now, this bike took me 25 hours of drawing to work out the whole project. And this is how I start a project. And I'm just going to tighten up my drawing now. Drawing's very important in every process that you'd work with. You got to practice this. Keeping a sketchbook, I think, is absolutely vital. All your ideas can go in there. You practice harder, you're going to get better. And you want to get to a point where you can sort of draw out of your head, and you really don't need a lot of reference. Although I keep reference around me all the time. I think it's super vital. I have a sort of a little formula that I devised, and this took me a lot of years to figure out. But if you can draw from life a third of the time, draw from flat reference a third of the time, and draw out of your head a third of the time, then you're going to be very well balanced in what you can do. I have to be able to paint a butterfly one day, a skull the next day, create a dragon out of my head the next day, do a landscape 3 days later. This is very important that you know how to do everything. Otherwise, you become sort of a one-trick pony that only can, say, paint horses or something. Now, I'm just fleshing this guy out a little bit more. Now, I don't like a nose on this. I started with a nose. I'm going to put a little half-hybrid skull to him. And this is where I start to chisel it out a little bit more. I can bring his eyebrow down and make him a little more evil. Again, playing off all the words that he gave me. And since I want him to communicate to the viewer, don't talk about this, shut up, I sewed his mouth shut. And so it had a purpose. It wasn't just a tricky device to look cool, although it does do that. You know, it had a purpose. It had to communicate too. I tighten this drawing up to a point where I can take it and make a stencil out of it. Now, this is a mapping process for me, and I had probably 25 stencils mapped out for this whole project. And I cut out a complete outline, and then I cut out my dark areas, and I'll show you how we work with that. So we're going to get a panel out in front of us, and we're going to get started on this. Right now, I'm just finishing up the prep on this panel. All I have to do is scratch pad all the shiny areas off, making sure that I have nothing left that's shiny. I'm just going to grab the wax and grease remover. This is a mild wax and grease remover for cleaning. I just pour it on, let it run down it. I wipe it into it, flip it around, wipe it off. What I'm using now is mineral spirits. Mineral spirits is a little bit of cleaner product, and it takes a little bit of the chemical off that wax and grease remover leaves behind. You can also hit this with air to make it dry faster. I'm going to shelf my panel right now in a clean spot and grab my stencil and my cutting board. All right, we have our stencil in front of us. I'm just going to start cutting it. Now, this first stencil cut is going to be my overall outline. So I'm just going to chase this all the way around. That'll get me a big positive, and the positive is a piece that comes out. The negative is the sheet that's left over. Now, I just kind of slowly follow around the outside form. This cut isn't hugely important, because I have a very soft project and I have a background that works very close to the colors in the face of the character. When you're setting up your place, your studio, I'm going to show you the best way to set up everything that works for me. Now, when you work in your shop, you might find it a little differently. Even right now, I'm sitting at a table that I can stand to because I work up and down. I like a table that I can walk around and move around. Okay, we've got this guy pulled out. There's our negative and there's our positive. Okay, we're just going to cut out all these block shapes. This is getting me my dark so I can map out my shapes. This is really important because you can lay out two of them the same, flip it on the other side of the bike tank, and you can actually go in and revalidate your holes. So if I get white overspray into an eye socket that's supposed to be dark, I can lay it back in, put it in dark right away. And for the beginner, this is really cool. You know, if you get overspray back and forth, you can go back in and remap it out and you haven't lost it. A guy's got to really think out his project before he starts something. I do a step procedure, and sometimes they're 10, 20 long, sometimes they're only 5 long, depending on the complexity of the project. If you can spend 20 minutes thinking about how you're going to do this project in the most efficient way, you can save yourself 4 or 5 hours, sometimes a couple days, in the end result on a project, just because you were smart on how you went about it. Experience is really important in determining how to come up with these steps, and this is going to take you some time. You're going to learn by your mistakes. And unfortunately, you should be learning on your own mistakes or your own projects, not your clients' projects, before you make these mistakes. So when you're first starting, you just got to think it out. Oh, it's better for me to do white before I go to my blue. I should mask this up. I should do the background first. No, wait. Maybe I can do the image first, then the background. That's a smarter way because I think it'll take me less time to mask this up. So until you get your feet wet, you may not know these steps, but really be thinking about it all the way through. This process will develop in your head and you will get better at it. But I mean, you are going to make mistakes and it's going to teach you along the way. I'm going to chase this around with freehand. I don't want this to look like a stencil when I'm done. I want it to look like I went in there and just freehanded. It looks very natural. So I spray very lightly and just use it as a mapping procedure. We're going to take a quick second look at our reference art. Reference is really important. Now, I didn't have the luxury of having this done before I started. Now, I could have done a panel first, but I did the bike first, the panel later. But we still have to create this out of our head to start with. So what we're going to do is we're going to take our stencil. I went a little bit larger so we can see things. And we're just going to concentrate on the face, and then we're going to make up some background later on in the project. When we were talking about planning out a project, I had to figure it out. So try to get a vision of what it's going to look like when you're done. And it's tough to have that vision, but once you get that vision, then you can try to work out the steps. Like, I know I'm going to go in with my lights first on a black panel. That's my first step. I'm going to cut my stencils out. There's another step. And I write those down in point form. And then I'm going to go into my slight darks and map out all my darks. And this is how I write down my step procedure. And then I try to follow it fairly close so I don't make any mistakes.
Okay, we have our panel in front of us and we have our positive. Now, there's three main approaches that you can do to airbrushing. I'm going to break it down really basically. We can work with a stencil. We could freehand. Or we could tape this all up with tape or transfer tape, and we could lay it out, draw on top of the transfer tape, cut it out. So you really have cutting, freehanding, and stencil work. So what we're going to do now is you've got to really consider the most dynamic way to approach something. This guy sitting like this on the panel looks a lot different than he looks like here than he does here. So now what's the most effective way? Well, I guess we have to think out the panel. What do we want to show? I'm going to load this guy down a little bit low. I'm going to keep this area dark, so I'm going to push him into the dark side. This gives me more room to play around up here if I want to add some stuff. And I think I want some wild sky in here. So now that we were dealing with placement, this is important when you tie it into your project. Now, this is a project that I have to work on next week when I get back to my shop. I have to consider angles. So when I take this face and tilt it on there, it's important to place it on the tank or on a fender, or if it's on a goalie mask or a helmet. You got to keep in mind where straps go and buttons and buckles on a goalie mask. You got to worry where the goggle straps on a motorcycle helmet are, where struts on a tank go, where the gas cap goes. You got to consider all these things. So I get mock-up photos from my client. I require 10 or 12 of them from different angles so I know every little aspect of that project. And I can really look at it and put it in for angles. I have to reassemble it on the tank. I'm going to have information lost from the side viewer because this guy put a beer holder on the side of his bike. So now I have to force my design up on either side so it matches. These are all important considerations in a project. And I want you guys to consider everything about a project. You got to consider form, color, shape, lighting, luminosity. All these terms are very important. And all these things, if you consider them, you can make your image more dramatic. Okay, I took my positive, laid it down, found where I wanted it, grabbed my negative, laid it over top of it, pulled the positive out, so I know my placement is correct. Now I'm just skirting this so I don't get overspray. I've just used transfer tape. You notice a bunch of toys here? I've just picked out a lot of nuts and bolts, and what this does, it keeps my edge down nice and tight so I don't get underspray under the paper. I've mixed up some white. I've diluted this in half. This is a transparent white from AutoWear Colors, and I use a mixture of clean solution to thin it out. And I know this ear is going to be bright. I'm looking at my reference up top here on that panel. So I'm going to start on my bright areas first. Just light passes. If you go too hard on this, it'll skate. And skating is where the paint sort of pills up, almost like a watercolor wash over crayons. Now this ear is nowhere near as light, so I can see it in my reference that the tip is very light. So I'm just going to just blow a little bit in the tip, I'm going to leave the rest of it alone. I'm going to use my positive, come back in and do a backdrop in white. And we're just building this up. I'm trying to find my sharpest highlight areas. And already I'm trying to map out my shapes a little bit. Under cheekbones are very subtle. That's all I need to do to start mapping that out. If you keep your mixture thicker, sure the paint goes on thicker and it only takes two or three coats. But as the paint mixture is thicker, you get a bigger dot pattern. It's almost like it gets pebbled and the paint goes on and your overspray carries further. It's tougher to control. So I prefer to spray a lot lighter with a thinner mixture and just take my time in this. Right now I don't know exactly where this cheekbone is. I'm just kind of relatively putting it in there. I might be a half an inch or a quarter inch out right now, and that's not going to be a big deal. We'll be able to find out where it is a little bit more when we get that positive in there. And the positive stencil will map out the eye and the nose, and then it'll be easier to find out where that cheek is. But I know it's going to be very close to there. I know it has to be bright, so I'm just going to get that area done. We pulled our negative off, and I'm having a look at this. We have some underspray that slid underneath. Now, I would have got bigger bolts or magnets on there to hold it down better if our background was important to save. Right now, the background isn't important to save because we have a lot of atmosphere coming in behind here. I'm going to put a lot of sky in here. I'm not concerned about it. So I'm going to grab my positive. I'm going to throw my positive back in and register all the lines on there. In my image, I want this half of the face to be very dark. So my background is going to be lighter on this side than what he is on the face.
Holding the airbrush and getting the right angle of approach is really important. A lot of people that come to the getaway come there and they're holding it with the wrong hand. They might be right-handed and they're holding it with their left, or they're holding it with their thumb. They might be very unorthodox because they're self-taught. Now, guys have trained themselves to work that way and have done very successful at it. Mark Fredrickson apparently does this with his thumb. Geiger does it too. I tend to hold it like this. I cup my hand, and by cupping my hand, it takes my shakes out. I get a little bit shaky if you're with one hand and you're going around like this, especially with straight lines. I call it triangulation. You're pivoting at your elbows, and you're kind of doing a pendulum with them. This will steady out your spray. And if you're doing this for 12 hours a day, you're going to fatigue and get tired. Your hand, when you first start, is going to probably cramp in the first 15 minutes. I like to do some stretches with my hand, push them against the table. Really stretch out and keep your hands loose and nimble. And by doing that, I can work 3 hours more a day. And that's really important in the long run. When you're standing here and you're approaching a project, you gotta look good. You never know when a camera's around. So your stance is very important. But serious, you really have to be on the right approach when you get in here. If you're not on the right angle, you're gonna be forcing overspray in the wrong direction. You're gonna force your lines to be crooked. So I've turned my project right around backwards. I want to spray this way to keep it away from my overspray. I'm guiding in, and I'm just doing a nice guide in here. I move around my project constantly, and I think this is really important. It's nice to have a table that you can walk around and a table that you can spin your project on, just so that you get that ideal approach with it. Now, I have my elbow locked right now, and I used to work really tight, like get in here, and that's how the name cross-eyed came about. You know, you're working so close, your eyes get tired. And I used to lock the elbow in. What happens is this muscle that attaches to your elbow runs right up to your finger, and you get a cramp in here. My assistant is getting it now, and it messed me up for about 4 months. I had to loosen up my approach and my angle. I had to open it up. Try to open up your elbow past 90 degrees every once in a while, and try to work a little further away from your project, and then just for your detail, go in and save your arm. It can happen over time. I went 12 years without a problem. The 13th year, just about, I didn't know what to do. I had to go see a doctor on it. And he says, you know, I'm just getting it locked in, and that muscle tightens up and it creates a cramp all the way through. And it lasts all the time. It aches even at night after you're done. So this is important to keep in mind. Now, we had this underspray in here that I said was no big deal, and it still isn't a big deal. I'm just adding to it now because we don't have the dragon in there anymore like in the original. And we don't have his hand in there like the original, so we're going to play with this and teach you some freehanding skills as well. I have some bright areas in here. I really don't need this guy anymore. If I start spraying this background, if you look really closely, you can see that I've created a line in here, and that's where my positive and my negative didn't register together. Now, the fact that this is bright in my image and the background has to get light, The overspray is next to nothing. I can go over top of everything right now on this side. My whites are just going to get brighter and my background's going to come together. And I won't create any of those lines. So to paint with my stencil right now isn't going to help me a bit. A lot of beginning airbrushers will make the mistake of making these lines so harsh and they'll just leave them there. It looks really amateur. So we're really trying for a very professional finish on this.
I'm just adding to my highlight source right here. This is going to be my light that is beaming down on them. I'm spraying this pretty thick right now. This is leading to another point because I'm seeing a cloud of smoke and I really should be wearing one of these things. But for the purpose of the video, you can't hear me at all, so I have to go without this. But really invest into one of these. This is really, really important with a solvent-based paint. These are carbon packs. Some guys in the industry will change these after every project. Chances are if you're blowing your nose and getting blue or red out of it, then you should have been wearing one of these. That's really important. As I get around to the outsides, I'm probably going to want to thin out my mixture so that I get a better green pattern. It keeps it simple. That's one of the things with auto air that's really difficult is getting that green pattern down to a really fine spray. And that's why I spray so thinned out. Now we're going to map out our areas that we have here for our darks. Now this is just the ear holes, the inside of the eye sockets, nose, nostrils, all the little details that we cut out in our dark stencil. So I'm going to start spraying those in. This would be a good time to mention that it's nice to have a little ventilation machine in front of you, something that moves the air or sucks the air out of your face. Another good thing that's going to make your body last is the floor. If you have a concrete floor, get yourself a couple soft walking mats or rugs in front of it that you can step on. They make a lot of pads like that for people to stand in the same area. It's going to save your back, your legs, your knee joints. So that's quite important as well. Now, I don't want to go real, real dark here. But you'll notice when we pull this off, I probably went way too dark on this crease in between his eyes. And that's going to be tough for me to get rid of. And we'll pull this off and I'll show you. And pull straight off because I'm wet. There we go. This is good because I can show you a mistake again. That top should be all dark. And I pulled my stencil off. My stencil rubbed against it. So now I've got to freehand that in or lay the stencil back down after it's dry and respray that area. We also have this problem up here too, a different problem. We created a line here, and this will be the inside of the ear, and it'll flow up. But we want a gentle flow out of it. And I've created a bit of a line here. I'm going to have to spray that out and get rid of it. And this side's doing the same thing. So you want to try to get that in there, or I could have cut my stencil out just a little bit wider, and that would have prevented a problem. Okay, this is a good time to really discuss getting your reference around you and your props. I'm painting a face right now. I have skulls around me. I have the prior project around me. I have the panel around me. When you're working on these projects, setting up your workspace with your reference, they all compete with each other. You have your paints in the way, you have your airbrush in your way, your holders. So really take time and set up your studio or your shop. I set up my workbenches up to a height where I can rest my elbows on it. I can stand, I can sit because I have a stool that pulls right up to it. I have three or four stools at different heights. This makes my job easier. The more I can do this, the better I can make my end result. We're spraying away right now and talking about our studio, but you're probably curious of what I'm doing right now. I'm just blocking in these big dark shapes. And I have a sort of a blue-brown mixture with a little bit of black. It's kind of grayed out, really translucent, and I'm just chiseling out the dark areas. This mixture is quite important not to get too dark. I don't use a black very often straight on unless I'm trying to match a black background, but right now with a lighter mixture, I can go over and make a lot of passes and really control my spray. When you're in your studio space or the shop space, like you might pick a studio, you know, it could be out of your home or out of your garage as opposed to a body shop. You've cut out a lot of contaminants, and lighting can change too. You have a window that's there, the lighting starts off sunny, then a storm rolls in or it gets dark outside. You don't want your reference to change. I might have a three-dimensional skull in front of me and I'm copying the lighting. Well, you're best using a nice artificial lighting because it's going to be consistent day or night. So I'm just going to keep working away on this. I'm just chiseling out all my areas slowly, building up the shapes. I haven't got in for extreme detail at all yet because I want to know where everything is and have it all mapped out properly first. As I'm studying the panel of this piece, I still have other supporting reference. The skull is here. This is out of Gray's Anatomy. It's a classic book on anatomy. You can't get better reference for bones and skulls. This project only requires this much reference for me to do. I could actually just do it from that panel. But some projects get so intensive that you need a lot of reference around you. I have a library of probably $15,000, $20,000 worth of books. This took a long time to build up. I gave myself a budget of $150 every month just to buy reference books. And it was tough. You weren't making a lot of money and you had to build it somehow. How you use the references is a unique thing too. You can take these photos out of things. I photocopy all the time, color and black and white. You can scan it into your computer and twist it around, stretch it and make things more interesting. I buy a magazine. I could be going through any magazine and all of a sudden there's a great reference for the snarling dog and I clipped it out about 8 years ago. I finally got to paint it about a year ago, but I knew I wanted to paint it eventually, and eventually I might get a client that's going to pay me to do so. I'm just working along this project right now, working into my light areas, detail and stuff. In my reference, I have a finger going over the mouth, so I'm making a lot of this up. Now I'm going to have to show more lighting on this than I did in the original reference, and that's because there's a shadow set up by the finger that crosses his mouth. So I'm going to have to make up a little more information on this one than I did on the original. Earlier I was talking about how you can take reference from life, from photos, and work out of your head. Now this is where we're combining all of them. That's getting a little dark right now, so I'm going to back off on that and just keep working around it while I still have this color going. It's very efficient to stick with the same color as long as you can. I can lay this in really lightly and I'm creating a nice little brown sepia gray. And this is chiseling out all my dark areas really lightly when I need to. And after I pound them really hard, it almost comes out like a black. I've also gone in here and put in a side neck that's in behind the shadow. And I'm blending it out and just pounding it in fairly strong.
We're going to take a quick break as this panel starts to dry and discuss products. Always pick the best products possible. I care about my results. I want the best product that I can possibly work with. There's lots of products that we can use on the market. Lots of pinstriping tapes. I use two or three different types because some applications, one is better than the other. With paints, I use a lot of these products, the AutoAir colors, but I also use solvent-based colors as well. And I use two or three different solvent-based paints for my applications. I also use different types of knives. I have my favorites. I use different types of pens and pinstriping brushes. I also use little art brushes to get detail. I also have another video coming out that incorporates the paintbrush with the airbrush. I use different paints of liquid acrylics as well. I find that this FW series is really good to paint with. Sometimes works a lot better than the AutoAir, but the AutoAir I predominantly spray with. With masking tapes, I've tried 6 or 7 different types. I carry 3 in my shop on a regular basis. Transfer tape, again, there's 3 or 4 different types of transfer tape, and I have 3 or 4 of those as well. It's like anything. Test your product, push it to the limit, and break the manufacturer's rules, find its limitations, then work within them. And this will make your job a lot better. In the last 16 years, I've seen a lot of products come and go. I've messed with them. I've made a lot of mistakes with them. This costs you a lot of money. Clients are mad. I'm frustrated. But when they work and you've tested them, it leads to this kind of success.
Now I've changed my mixture now that I'm back into the panel here. I've created a mixture that's kind of dirty and muddy. I've added some yellow, some root beer, and a little bit of black, and that's kind of greened it out. As soon as you add the black to it, it gets it kind of muddy. Now I called the client back after he gave me those 6 words and told him that I really wanted to do some muddy atmospheric look to this. It was a little bit of a sell on him, but he had confidence in me, so that was nice. And this gets around to how you deal with your client in your market. I've situated myself in a market that is very bad, you know, everybody likes badass stuff in my market. So if my portfolio was filled with butterflies and underground water scenes and dolphins and stuff, I probably wouldn't survive in my market. If my portfolio, I shipped that off to Hawaii and tried to work there, I would starve to death as well. So really know your market and what you want to try to work on. So once you've got your kick-ass portfolio all together and you're really proud of it, then you got to find out what you want to work on. If you live in a market like Arizona, well, there's a ski resort in Arizona, but say you lived in Mexico City, I'm not so sure doing snowboards is going to be a good market for you. It's good for my market if I really wanted to push that. I focused on bikes. I have a lot of bikers in my area. That's perfect for me. You might want to work on helmets or masks or vehicles or even do t-shirts. You know, t-shirts are big business in some markets. It's not in my market. I would starve to death doing t-shirts. So really pick and know your market. That's really important for you. Then you can take that portfolio and get them into the shops that deal with that. Do a couple freebies maybe for the owner of that shop or the guy who works behind the counter. And then he'll start marketing you and pushing for you. And he'll get his buddies and clients to come into his shop.
I'm into a light blue now. And I have a lot of blue on the top edge of this guy. I'm just going to blend in a little bit of blue into the wrinkles. I'm starting to get some detail in this a little bit, but I'm still saving my white highlights. Now, you want to get paid for your projects, too. So the biggest question down at the getaways has got to be, how do I price my work? Everybody prices different. Some guys are very militant. It's just how many hours that I put in, that's what you pay. I think this leads to a little bit of an argument with the client afterwards if you spend 100 hours and he is expecting 30 hours. I quote my jobs a little differently. I quote them based exactly on what it's going to be when he comes in. We establish a budget together. So the budget might be $3,000 for a top bike or $4,000. But I've calculated that the idea I've worked out with him, I can do in so many hours. I want to get so much per hour. And if I spend more time on the project to get it done, because the quality is the most important thing, I'll lose hours. I've quoted on a 100-hour bike and spent 130 hours on it. I got paid for 100 hours. And that's not the client's fault. I just took it too far. You know, I become my own worst enemy at times. But if I try to charge that client another 70 hours or 20 hours or $400 or something, I might piss him off. He won't be back. He'll tell his friends that he got screwed by my company. You know, a lot of guys are establishing themselves in and pricing their stuff, thinking they're really awesome. You know, there's a real lack of talent out there. And you need to really push yourself a little bit harder. Just because your grandma thinks your stuff's good, it doesn't mean it really is. So really get your stuff evaluated. Be humble about this. You know, you're learning, and it's going to take a while to get good at it. If you're pricing yourself at $3,000 or $5,000 or $200 even, you know, it should reflect your quality. Most likely, if your quality is really bad and you've made a lot of mistakes, you know, you look at it 5 months later and you go, God, I really don't like this. I can do so much better. Chances are you weren't ready to be in the job market yet. Now, quality can be really subjective. You know, I'm pretty good at judging stuff. I'm quite critical of my own stuff and critical of everybody else's as well. It's not that you're mean, it's just a truth. You want to make your stuff look so professional, and the bad projects really do scream as an eyesore. I can tell in a second, and so can a lot of people. Keep in mind, your market's probably pretty small. The bike community, they talk. They all know what my next project is. So one bad project is going to stand out like a sore thumb and probably hurt you more than 20 good ones will. Okay, I'm working along here, and I'm going to show you some mistakes now. Especially mistakes that the amateur, or the first guy who starts, makes. I've made them. I've been through this. I'm not above it. I still make them daily. The biggest one that I get in the shop when I'm training my guys is save your whites. I try to build these whites up. I'm trying to keep them. I can tell already in here that I have enough overspray in here that I'm going to have to go in and punch my whites, especially right in here. This area right here is way too dark in there. Take a look at that same area over here. There's some white highlights in there. I've already gone too dark on my reference. I'm going to have to go back in there. This is a wasted step for me now, because I have to go back in and do this, then go back in with darks. I did not save my whites. I say this to my students and to the guys that work for me probably 5-6 times a day, and some of them just don't get it. If you do it really wrong, you've obliterated your project. You might as well start again. All the time you put into it was wasted. Okay, I'm going to go into another problem. Remember earlier we pulled that stencil off and I shook it in here? I went in here and I tried to fix it up. I'm trying to pound this in. I got a really thin mixture, and I'm not going to show you a mistake. Flap. Look at that. See that? That's a big mess. I'm going to get rid of it right away so I can fix it quickly. Guys do this all the time, airbrushing, and that's a huge mistake. Here's another mistake I've made, and it's not my mistake. This is my paint isn't working really well with my airbrush right now. My mixture isn't very good. I maybe need to clean my brush out a little bit, but it's spitting. This does it a lot. Your airbrush tends to run more poorly than it does amazingly over the course of a lifetime. So you're constantly trying to change parts, change mixture, change your paint, spray it at a different pressure to make it work. So when you go home and you're working with any paint, any airbrush, and you find that this is happening and this is happening, you have to compensate for it. And this is going to be a lifetime battle for you in this industry. When it's spraying nice, it's perfect. Like, look at this. You can get down really tight. But sometimes you get in small, and it starts to skip a little bit. Now, you'll get something like this in it a little bit. It'll jump. Or you spray it in, and you'll get dot patterns to either side. And these will be all chronic examples of why your brush is going bad, and you're just going to have to deal with it and try to overcome it. I'm going to continue working on the details here, and I'm just going to talk about the next problem that causes artists to really crater themselves, and that's bad planning. You do a step out of order, then you might create two more steps, and if you can coordinate your project really well, chances are you might be able to cut out one of those steps. If you cut out one step in a project, you might find that it saves you 2-3 hours. So you really want to do your planning out and make sure it's the most efficient way possible. Again, only experience is going to tell you how to do this.
I've spent a little bit of time on this, added some blue, and it's sort of a bluish-brown mixture. And I went in and just tinted the whites. What that does is it gives it like a clown makeup look. I want that kind of feel to it, kind of an eerie creepiness. You can't totally tell what it is. And not being able to tell what it is adds to the mystique of this guy.
I also got a little bored with his round bowling ball looking head. He had a dragon on in the original. I got a little bored in here, so I just started to mold out some crowns. All of a sudden, he's going to have a little bit more of a creepiness to him. What I did down here is I got rid of my whites. I didn't save them there. So now I have to go back in, and I have to reestablish my white there. This is just a small area, so it's not punishing me too bad. But if I do this everywhere on the project, well, it was kind of a waste of time putting my darks in. So now, since I have the white going here, I'm just gonna go around and really establish where I want my brightest highlights. And again, I know there's gonna be a big highlight in here, so I'm just kind of punching that up a little bit. I think it got a little dark here. And what we're gonna do is chisel out some edges. Oh, now there, hey, good, we got a new mistake. When we get a spit like that, we have one or two, maybe three problems possibly. I could have, when I mixed it, dripped out a little bit of my thinner fluid, and it dripped down the side, came down to here, and eventually found its way to the tip. As soon as it caught air, it went bam, and hit my project. Okay, so now that I have this white, I got to fix that up a little bit. I'm just going to chisel this top edge, and I have these little spider webs in there now. It doesn't look that bad, it just looks like his nose is cracking, and that's kind of cool too. It's nice to see some of these mistakes in here too. It makes you feel kind of human. You know, it doesn't matter what level you're at, we all get them. We've all dropped paint, we've all wrecked projects, we've all made mistakes. At this point in the project, I just got to get in and get some of the scales done on the neck. This is a kind of a detail area. You can do this a lot of ways. You can go in with a paintbrush. And keep in mind this neck rolls underneath, so you don't want all your little scales in there starting right along this line. If you start a few of them halfway, like so, it shows that it rolls underneath. And start making your ellipses as it rolls around his neck. These ellipses are little balls or scales that I'm putting on them. I'm going to make them in a dimension. Make the circle a little thinner. As it thins in, you're going to see less of it. And that oval will look like it's rolling around. To create a really fine line, you have to be in really tight and just pull back minimally. I'm not pulling back very far at all. If I did, I'd have a big mess on my hand. This isn't easy to do. This takes a lot of time. Your brush and your equipment has to be working really, really well. Now at the end here, I'm just going to put little half ellipses like this. Just bend arcs around them, and that gets it to disappear around. And I'm just going to fade these out on the neck. Maybe put some tendon type shapes that blend out of his neck. Right now, I've got a lighter mixture with more yellow. I'm just putting a bottom tone how the light would hit it. And then I chase around the little corners and the edges and the cracks where the circles are. And this is just going to darken them up and make them feel like they're little crater holes in between them. Okay, I finished up doing some of these. I'd like to spend more time on this area, but right now we have to get this done. The client is pushing me really hard. He wants to ride his bike this weekend. And it's already Thursday, and he wants to ride Saturday morning, so we have to work fast now. What I'm doing is just throwing some highlights in, punching them up, catching the edges of these ones along the edge so they roll around. What you're doing is you're showing three or four of these big round ones right on the edge as they roll around his neck. Now this section here, so far I've approached this with just three colors. The original I did in about 9 colors, so you can really make this stuff complex if you want. A lot of artists have a lot of problems with this next dilemma. That's not finishing this to the highest quality possible. A lot of guys just go, huh, that's good enough, we're done. It's not done yet. You know, I could work this for a long time. And my demands on the clients, I have to take it to a certain level where I'm happy with it and I'm pleased with it. And honest to God, I just try to do it better than my competition around. I find that I'm annoyed by areas, so I keep working until I'm not annoyed. And that's probably a good time to stop. I've got a dark color that just came out from underneath the jaw, and I'm working this up, and this is a problem right here, and I'm going to show you what a problem is right there. Now, it doesn't look horrible until you pull out the reference. Now, take a look at that same area here.
Look at how smooth the transition is here. There's not a sharp line along there that's smooth into the background. It's nice and soft, yet it's still clear and concise. This one here is outlining. Now, outlining tends to wreck a project. It makes things look cartoony. Now, some guys can pull this off very well. Javier Soto can pull this off well. He has a bit of a graffiti cartoon style to his a little bit. He can get away with outlining a little bit in areas, and it works. But if you're going to chase this all around everything with an outline, and a lot of amateur airbrushers do this, follow everything with an outline and chase everything with an outline. To me, it's a cartoon. Okay, I'm going to deal with the warm areas around the eye right now. I'm putting in a yellow with a little bit of root beer in it. And I'm tinting this in right now, trying to save my highlights. And the reason I'm going in with this color is if I went in with red right now, and predominantly around his eye it looks red, you have to have a warmer color underneath it or you'll create pink. So for me to get these in here, I really like to warm it up with a yellow first, then an orange, and then hit it with my reds. I just did a clown skull the other day, and I cut a corner on it, and I went in and I tried to chisel out the makeup around his eye in red, and I got pink around it, and I made a mess of it. I had to start again. I thought I knew better. That cost me another half an hour. If I had taken my time with it, did it right, I would have had it done in 10 minutes. I went in with an orange now, and this is just going to warm it up a little bit more. I know I harp on time a lot and trying to make money at this. It's really important if you're going to spend 50 hours, say, on that neck or around this eye, and you're only getting paid for 10, eventually you will go out of business. It's hard to stay in business when you're eating that much. It's a difference between $50 or $40 an hour or $10 an hour or $4 an hour. Other things you have to do if you're going to keep the doors open in your shop and make a living at this, or even a side living out of this. You have to have your people skills down. If you can't talk to your customer and figure everything out, and you can't deal with them, and you refuse to answer the phone, they're going to stop calling you. You also have to be good with money. You can't go to your client and say, I need all the money up front because I have to buy paints. He's not going to have confidence to work with you at all. You have to save your money enough so you can buy equipment, the proper stuff. If you make a mistake, you got to be able to pay for it. Ambition's another one. A lot of good artists, they fall by the wayside like crazy because they just can't get the ambition up. They won't get out of bed in the morning. You know, they want to sleep in, turn into a night owl. Well, your clients aren't calling you at 3 in the morning all the time. They might be calling you at 9 a.m. You're not there to deal with them. Eventually, they might go away as well. I like the ends of the project the best, where I can just go in and start chiseling it out and really making this sucker sing. I love going in and throwing the highlights in. I collect a lot of antiques, and I love the rustic part, and actually I pull a lot of the stuff off my antiques and put it into my projects. Kind of a weird influence, but I mean, that's where some of the stuff comes from. By picking these bright colors right here, they really, really do scream. And the reason they scream is because all my other colors are very muted. I'm using earth tones and muddy colors everywhere else, and this red all around the eye is bringing your eye to it. I've worked this for about 25 minutes off camera. It doesn't look like I did a whole pile. I've really chiseled in my darks a lot. I went in and revalidated the nose, the darkness in there, fixed my little mistake, started chiseling out the cheekbones inside here a little bit more. Still has a ways to go. Now I have this dark in here. I'm just going to pound a little bit of this into the background, get rid of some of my white overspray. There's a bit of brown in this black right now. And this is going to slowly resemble a little bit of our background in our panel. In dealing with this background, we'll get back to our client briefly. I told him I wanted this heavy atmosphere. And I kind of wanted it like underwater. There was dragons flying around. And I wanted them to look like the stingrays that just float through the water. So by all this muddy colors in my background, we've really achieved this really heavy, heavy atmosphere. With me spraying this right now, I have a yellow-brown mixture with black. The black is giving me a bit of a green tint to it. And it's getting very close to the colors that I have in the original. Along the top of the head, I want to be a little bit tighter if I want it a bit darker behind it. This will get his highlight on his head to stand out a little bit. This is a point where I can grab my reference. I'm going to take my positive, just register it on there really quickly. This is important to get right now, or I'll create that double line again. And I'm not looking for a real hard line here, so I'm going to spray from straight above. That'll get my stencil down. Trying to save the white a little bit right at the top part here. And that's where the luminosity and the energy source of the light on him will come from. I'm just chiseling out a few more details in his forehead right now, a little bit darker. And this is a good time to address trying to make things a little bit different.
This isn't the first time a creature's ever been created in the world, and I'm not even going to pretend it is. There's a lot of trends that go on in art, and it's nice to try to find your own trend. Try to find something that you really dig and make yourself a little bit different. This is tough to do when you have clients, though. Clients are going to want what's common, what they see in the magazines. But you're going to have to push them to put your own spin on it, and really push for variety. Wherever you get your energy from and your strength from, really feed on it and look for new stuff and try to do new stuff. Try to amalgamate old stuff with new stuff. I've swapped over to white right now, and I'm just chiseling out highlights. This is like a big light source. It's feeding out through the clouds. And this light is just going to come out and beam down on them. And I'm really trying to emulate the old theater where the spotlight came down and just sort of pounded on the main character on stage singing a song. We're going to address the highlight problem here, or lack of highlights. This is where we really have fun. This is my favorite part, just making stuff sing. Can you see that? There's a little bit of water coming off of there. As that builds up, that's what comes down and splatters onto your thing. I caught it before it happened, but we just about had that happen again to us. I don't know exactly what causes this. There is a pressure fit seal. It's metal against metal and a lot of threads. It shouldn't do it, but it does do it occasionally. And it seems to only do it when you have a lot of cleaning fluid in it. Now I'm putting a little bit of highlight. I'm just chasing a really fine highlight on the bottom edge of a lot of these wrinkles. And that is because the wrinkle will dive in and the skin will bubble up over it. The light will come down and just hit that and give you a little bit of a highlight just above it. The reference for this is really easy. I didn't bring any, but at home when I first started the first one, I just got a photo from National Geographic of some old codger sitting on a chair in front of an old general store. You saw the million age lines in them. This might be necessary if you don't feel confident about making it up in your own head. All right, I've tinted this again, followed out my white highlights, blended it out with a tint like we did earlier, and it's getting really close. But right now I noticed something really gaping. I looked at the stitches, I haven't approached those. That's kind of the last thing anyways. So I'm going to lay my stencil back in, and wow, this is pretty fascinating. It looked like they're okay right there, but actually you can see the lips right through the whole thing. I'm just going to start spraying in my darks. I have a dark brown black in here with a little bit of blue. I'm going to go really dark in the holes. I'm just going to follow the stencil right around the bottom and right around the top. These holes are going to get a little bit darker as they punch through his skin. I'm going to get a little tricky here, and I'm going to change to a white. I'm just going to lay a white highlight, and this will give the bands of each stitch a bit of a highlight. And I'm just going to take about the highest point where I think the light is going to hit it. Now, without taking my registration off, I'm going to flip it up and see if that worked. Yeah, there we go. We've got a real bitching character here. I'd like to spend another 4 or 5 hours on him to complete him, but for the purpose of this video, we're done. I've given you a lot of cool information. I want you to kick ass with it. I'm Blake McCulley from Cross-Eyed Airbrushing. Thanks for watching.